Okay. Well, it's great to be in Manchester. I haven't been for a while. I think actually the last time I was invited, it was some awful train strike. I couldn't make it. So I'm surprised they bothered the second time. But thank you. And Edmund, thank you very much for the great, generous introduction. It's a very hard act to follow Rebecca's and the beautiful performance of Bach. I'll do my best. Start off with the first poem of a new book called Anomaly. It was a kind of default title, but anyway, it's called The Hunters. We that have been hunting all the day are mighty tired. Our hair is dank with sweat, and by our hunting helmets plastered flat. As days of hunting go, this must be counted a good day. The horns blew loud, and the dogs barked hard, as though they knew it was more for them than us. We went out hunting the wild beast all day, so they could teach him just how tame they were, and how wrong to think that being dogs had taken the edge off their appetite for sport. We that have been hunting all the day will keep on hunting through the night, for finer creatures of the forest hide through forests deeper than the ones of day. Just say something about the form of that. It's, proper poets invent forms, you know, whether it's Provençal poets who've invented the Villanelle, the Sestina, and the sonnet emerging. This is a slightly disinvented form. It's, I think of it as a limping villanelle. As in, for a villanelle, the tricky thing is you need at least two good lines because they keep repeating. I only got one, and actually I stole it, I'm afraid, from Haywood, the nice line I repeat, we that have been hunting all the day. A Thomas Haywood, his play called The Woman Killed by Kindness. I read it, and I thought, God, that's a good line. And then the next line, we that have been hunting all the day have prepared stomachs. I thought, I can do better than that, give us a job. I'm not sure I did, but... actually, since I'm talking about this form, which I'd like to copyright, something I did yesterday, and I know it takes a bit cheek to foist a new untested poem on a proper audience, but this is somewhat in the same form. It has an unhelpful title, The Fern Harrier. You won't find the word fern in any dictionary, I'm afraid, but I think of it as a kind of insect. I've been trying to gather together an insect anthology from which I have to, in all modesty, exclude myself, so I'm going roundabout and writing my insect poems. This shares the same form. So fern is spelled T-H-U-R-N for all the good that does you. It's called the fern harrier. The fern was harried from his house. So the fern was harried from his home by a bailiff beetle with an acid aura in a waistcoat ground and red as Rome. By then, the fern was utterly alone. Rain turned to ice on his ruffled brow. The fern was harried from his home. He stuffed some pamphlets in his case, half a loaf and a chunk of lava. The sun was dull as tarnished chrome. The fern's vocabulary was sparse, but still had room for several curses. He said to himself as he fled his home. The harrier thus had earned his hire. The fern was harried from his home. I don't know if it's in relation to the national crisis, but I've scattered this book with all kinds of poems with titles in foreign languages and quite a lot of phrases. I'm slightly reluctant to do it. I mean, I don't want a book with notes, you know. But at least in a reading, I can kind of vaguely explain what I'm up to, if many people would know anyway. There's an Italian expression, la colonna sonora, which is a rather beautiful word for soundtrack. Actually, I like soundtrack as well, for a film soundtrack. So I was trying to imagine a sonorous column, which is what it translates as. And then it came into my mind that brilliant, I don't know if you know the film, but the Taviani brothers, Padre Padroni, set in Sardinia, where I've been going recently quite a lot. And in Sardinia you have, and he has as a background music, what's often referred to as canto a tenore, or a bordone. And it's basically four male voices, three of which imitate animals. It's the most uncanny and weird sound, but it's one of the things that makes the Taviani film so great. So anyway, that explains the canto a tenore. La colonna sonora has a better ring to it than soundtrack, more vertical, classical, Herculean, like a pillar of water sustaining a cloud, a fluted column on a celluloid plinth that turns our voices into architecture, or laid on its side like a wooden flute, a hollow tube with owlish eyes that blink. When I think of these sonorous columns, the one that wakes in my ear is the wind loud in the holm oak at the edge of his world. The peasant boy hears in Padre Padroni, the belling sheep, the canto a tenore, all the drone and clamour of creation, crushing each creature with the force of nature. Where to go from there? Since Rebecca was mentioning the promenade, which is where I was up, I was brought up in Liverpool, or more or less, with this great view of Garston Docks and the River Mersey all the way to Portsmouth. Well, my little sister's gone up in the world and is living in St. Michael in the Hamlets. It sounds very rural, but it's a slightly fancy enclave, a small enclave in Liverpool near Egbert. Anyway, it's graced with a church which, for some unknown reason, I start ranting on about. It's the most ungenerous description, but I think if you understand them, or the speaker is there looking after his ailing parent. So it switches from another bit of foreign stuff. There's a bit of German which is basically saying, help, it's a German colonel, I haven't drunk for 4 days. 5 days, I've said, that's almost impossible, he must have got some juice. But anyway, he's picked up and helped, can't change it now. Actually, if anyone knows the church, it's quite acceptable. But somehow in a bad mood, some churches look dreadful. St. Michael in the Hamlet. God, it's ugly, that church. I have a privileged outlook on. Each time I trudge up north to clock in for the ministry of my pinched quota of care. But ugly falls, and not short of its damp brick and dead salmon colour scheme. Its fat, jaggedly tapering square tower topped with oversized fake Gothic finials in the same unappetizing marzipanish pink that graces the stretch ogives of its rusted iron windows. Windows missing a few lozenges of clear glass and ending in ventilation slats embodged with pigeon cack. Completed between the eruption of Mount Tambora and the Battle of Waterloo, it seems to have been finished in blood-stained lava and sports a skeleton of cast iron, trademark of the builder John Cragg, who owned the Mersey Iron Foundry and built the house I write in. Wielding weight and welding clumpish structures skyward, maybe God doesn't give a damn for churches or good taste, which is not to say he doesn't have any. He might prefer a simple heart, a wasp's nest, or a lean-to shed to this dreary steeple house that somehow fluked the grade one listing. But ugly as this church, most surely is it still worse luck, more home to me than any mosque or duomo in peerless travertine or marble. Though I've other things to care about than this, such as filling out tablets or emptying a bottle of piss left beside the threadbare throne my father's realm has shrunk to, before my name is boomed out once again in his still undiminished base. The cloud of darkness that's been gathering for months slowly leaves his face as he tells me of the German colonel who'd gone scouting too close to the English line at Bremen and was blown up by a shell. The Worcesters found him lying on his side with multiple fractures to all four limbs. Hilfe was all he said, fünf Tage und nix zu trinken. My father patched him up as best he could and always wondered if he made it, the only German he'd felt sorry for. In the night he shouts to my sister, demands she calls an ambulance. This minute, can't she see the colonel's dying? He points to the floor. It's a bloody disgrace to leave him lying there. Oh yeah, another foreign title, here we go. Rebecca was talking about the playing with, off or against artist work. I do work a bit in the visual arts, but also I've written reviews of artists, and I've liked to build a wall between the two processes. I kept them apart, but now the wall is crumbling. It's a sign of moral turpitude. I'm now writing poems about pictures or things. Actually, you know, that horrible word ekphrastic, I try and avoid it, but I didn't really see the point of describing in words a picture. I mean, you're on a losing wicket. So what I'm trying to do is to move off from it. In this one, it's got a French title, L'homme qui chavire, which is a famous sculpture by Giacometti. It's a very brilliant sculpture of somebody in severe tilt. So it's more the idea that I'm exploring, certainly not a description of the brilliant artwork. I have to find it. L'homme qui chavire. Chavire is to capsize as well as to fall. So it sounds a bit odd in English as I start off saying a falling man. But anyway, perhaps it's acceptable. 26. It's nice to have an enthusiastic L'homme qui chavire. The falling man, if that makes sense, is falling into a void he has failed to avoid, and nothing has prepared him for. And the air, the vagrant air that served to hold him up, has taken flight to uphold something else elsewhere. His own 2 feet on which he used to stand have lost their foothold, pied sans terre. The axis that aligns his thigh bones with his pelvis and his spine is a capsized keystone and a veering steeple. A sad jumble of anatomy, who knows what witchy pins or poultices can couple. I fell off my bike, that's accounts for the bitter tone. I bust my femur and arm. It's vaguely associated, it's called The Flight. It's my own version of Swing Low, Sweet Child. The Flight. Others look down on me as well they might. I look down on myself from a great height. See the tramp's straggly hair, turned white, the off-white of effluent polluted seafoam, the bony shoulders, the incipient bald dome, and black wings sprouting that will fly me home. I might try one more long poem if you could bear it. And since I've taken you away, but Edmund has kindly introduced me to the translating, this is a slightly mean poem addressed to the excellent poet and translator Stephen Romer, who is the translator of the great French poet Yves Bonfoy. And yes, it's a slightly disrespectful poem to Yves Bonfoy, but I'd like you to believe that it's not me, it's someone else I can blame, the speaker of the poem. You know? I think Stephen thought I was making a critique of his author, but actually it's more I'm speaking from a slightly resentful person. If you do a lot of translation, it's very ill-paid work, and it does make you deeply resentful. There's bits of French, but I'm sure they're clear. Je ne parle pas mi, I haven't got a driving license. It's not true of me, it's him. I don't really think I need much else. Translating Yves Bonfoy. I was eating alone in Arezzo, eavesdropping on the conversation of Yves Bonfoy, who happened to be at the next table with his Italian translator. My hearing, alas, is bad as my French, my memory hardly better, which made me far from fit to profit from this chance the muses or the maître d'eux had served me up with. I had little doubt I was in the presence of greatness, his age impressive and his face forged by the time-scented air of the Midi. I tried to shush the tune for that, as only the deaf know, plays havoc with the ears. Someone, the poet said, had a montant immense, almost the start of a poem. It reminded me of Joyce's sentence, Maria had a very long nose and a very long chin, and when she smiled, they almost met. In all likelihood, a misquote. The word voiture alerted me to a change of tack. Je n'ai pas le permis. Forgive me. Being driven by his wife was either a boon or a curse. I couldn't hear which. Much droll detail followed, lost on me, but I could take or leave his views on cars, for it's not a topic poets excel on. And even if I hadn't made one, I've driven from Naples to Liverpool and back again and spent hours after spare parts in oily dumps. However, in a lower, shielded tone, during the next course, he spoke of la parole, la poésie de concept, la réalité, le cinéma. This was the stuff I most needed to catch. Having read his Rambo book when just out of my teens and not finding there what I was earnestly looking for, now, the lost gold might belatedly surface and all my confusions be resolved. But no such luck. I began to feel uneasy like Gene Hackman in the conversation, only without his direction of Zoom microphones. Another clear phrase which I translated as Americans speak English, but it might have been the English Americans speak, the first almost incontrovertible, the second needing some development really to qualify as wisdom, such as the English Americans speak is richer and stranger than the English speak. If so, I would willingly speak American. Speak to myself, that is, in the perfect accent I almost always achieve when no one's listening. I could not fault Yves Bonifoy's French accent. It was marvelous, liquid, like a native speaker's. Only he received relatively low marks for audibility. He was clearly indifferent to his extended audience, and I can't help feeling that counts against him. Perhaps you'll say I ought to read his poems. Well, doubtless I should. In the meantime, though, I'd be none the wiser. So I returned to my own heavy thoughts and my plate of earthy beans and bitter chicory. No, I think maybe it's time for one more. Oh, try not to make it a long one. Okay. Yeah, a short one. Maybe an old one. This is, I mean, like, there's quite a lot of stolen lines and phrases, plagiarized, I think you call it, in this, but this is even more so. It's like pieced and glued together out of, I don't remember what it was, I better find it when I remember. Yeah. I think it's from St. Augustine, because I gave an epigraph from him. It's called The Perils, and I'll read the epigraph from The City of God by St. Augustine. It's a slightly blackmailing argument about why you should believe. The various reviewers of it took it dead seriously and said it should have gone on. I meant it rather the opposite way, so like slightly to parody or to question. But no. Anyway, the St. Augustine's, the City of God, think of the perils of seafarers and the perils of travellers by land. Anyone walking anywhere is liable to sudden accidents. One would suppose the sitting posture to be perfectly safe. And yet, that's where I cut him off. Mind you, it's nothing like being hit by lightning. Having said that, the first time I read this was at Edinburgh. I contentedly sat down after my reading on a plastic chair, which folded underneath me. It was either God's or St. Augustine's revenge. Anyway, the perils. Maybe it's not all parodic, because I mean, sure, lots of bad things happen. And I'll finish with this one. Thank you for listening. The perils. We may be wise enough to shun the waves, but only folly would suppose the land is safe. Land is deeper than the sea. Rock, sand, and soil will have their perils. Quakes raise and floods submerge our habitations. One bite from a rabid dog makes man feared by his own family as much as any wild beast. The body itself is heir to more foul diseases than the books the physicians can accommodate. Walking anywhere is constant danger. Even seated at my desk to write this, I remember the priest Eli who fell from his chair, never to rise again. Thank you.